The Bible gives us tantalizing glimpses of the future, mysterious prophecies, like a perfect roadmap to the end times. I bet we all wish we had one of those. Well, if you have one of these, you have the roadmap. So let's once again put on our Sherlock Holmes hat and check out what the Bible has to say about the order of events in the end times. When does the tribulation start? With a peace treaty? What about the rapture? When are the famines? What about wars? And what about the coming of the Antichrist? Jesus' disciples were absolutely no different than we are today about this issue. They wanted to know what was in store in the future. So a day or so before Jesus was betrayed, they asked him directly. They wanted to know when the end time events would occur and what signs would be given that those times had come. Did Jesus rebuke them and say, "You can't know about these things"? No, quite the opposite. Jesus took the time to explain the end times in vast and expansive detail across two chapters of the Gospel of Matthew. He included numerous road signs that are found along the way, and four parables and other illustrations to carefully explain what he meant. 36 verses of that chapter provide the road signs to this roadmap of the end times. We call this the Olivet Discourse, although all the illustrations and parables are also technically part of the Olivet Discourse. I bet you're thinking, well, that's nice, but I wish these same events were listed somewhere else so we would know their timing. Well, you're in luck. The 13 identical events in exactly the same order are found in Revelation. Really, you might ask? Why didn't I know this before? This changes everything. Yes. Yes, it does change everything about how we've thought about the end times. I can't answer why you haven't been taught this, but most of the 13 events have been apparent to prophecy teachers for some time. John Walrood, the George Washington of the pre-trib rapture theory, had this to say. There is a remarkable parallel between the progress of Revelation chapter 6 and the description of the end of the age given by our Lord in Matthew 24, 4-31. Another pre-trib expert, Andres Kostenberger, and his co-authors included an elaborate table showing the similarities in their book, The Cradle, The Cross, and The Crown. Pre-wrath expert and my personal friend, Alan Kirshner, has also provided an extensive table of the similarities, but Alan noticed that the similarities extend beyond Revelation chapter 6 all the way to chapter 8. We'll get to this point in a moment. And even the venerable Thomas Ice of the Pre-Trib Research Institute admitted the similarities in his recent debate with Kirshner. A veritable who's who of prophecy teachers all see some similarities between the Olivet Discourse, Matthew 24, and Revelation chapter 6. So why keep this a secret among only prophecy teachers? Let's see it for ourselves. If we lay these two great passages of Scripture side by side, we can see all 13 comparisons. If you look at Matthew 24, you can see these 13 signs and the order they occur in. Then, when we compare to Revelation chapters 6 through 8, we see the same exact events in the same exact order. This is the roadmap to the end times. All these major signs running exactly parallel to one another. If we look at this eagle eye version of the biblical text that you see on your screen, it really makes this apparent. Now we're going to look at each event separately and compare the two versions. But before we do that, if you've been enjoying the video, please subscribe by simply pushing the small red button in the lower right. You can push this button at any time during the video. If you click the bell, you'll get notifications of our new videos suggested to you as well. Now that you've subscribed, let's begin examining the signs. In Matthew 24, Jesus told us that false prophets and messiahs are going to be the first sign. They will come in Jesus' name. And in Luke's version of this account, he tells us that they will say, "I am he." Does this mean they will claim to be the historic Jesus? Most likely, it does. In Revelation 6, the parallel sign is the rider of the white horse who brings deception in the form of these false messiahs. The white horse is symbolic of them pretending to be Jesus who rides a white horse at the end of Revelation. There are two other unique aspects of this first sign. The rider of the white horse carries a bow with no arrows. What does this mean? The first reference to a bow with no arrows in the Bible is God's bow, which he set in the sky as a covenant with the earth not to destroy it again with water. A bow with no arrows is a sign of a covenant not to continue hostilities. Are the false messiahs promising peace or lack of destruction of the world? Are they suggesting a nuclear disarmament? It isn't clear, but maybe. The other greatly misunderstood term in this first sign is the aspect of what type of conquering the rider tries to accomplish. Are these false messiahs trying to conquer by military means? The Greek word translated conquer is nikao, which can mean conquer, but which is most frequently translated overcome in the New Testament, as in do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good, Romans 12:21. So isn't it more likely these false messiahs are spiritually trying to conquer and deceive rather than conquering with military means? In Matthew 24, Jesus told us that the second sign will be wars and rumors of war. In a parallel passage in Luke, he adds the idea that it will be a time of chaos. In Revelation 6, the parallel sign is the rider of the red horse. He will take peace from the earth and cause terrible bloodshed. He is also given a great sword. Is that nuclear weapons? In Matthew's parallel account, we are told that there will be earthquakes. The Greek word is seismos, which can also mean great shakings. Might this be indicative of nuclear war? Maybe. In Matthew 24, Jesus told us that the third sign would be that there would be famines. In Revelation 6, the parallel sign is the rider of the black horse, who we hear quoting a price for wheat and barley. The price quoted for wheat might bake a loaf of bread, yet it is an entire day's wages. This would mean that in the future, the cost of bread might be $120 a loaf based on today's wages. Obviously, you wouldn't be able to afford much bread at those prices. That would be a famine. Is this the point where the false prophet institutes the mark of the beast so that no one can buy or sell without it? Again, maybe. At this point, Jesus paused and termed these three initial signs the beginning of the birth pangs. In this way, he compared the end times to the birth of a baby. And although these initial events will be painful, they won't be as painful or as continual as the full labor pains to come. Most scholars, me included, believe these first events take place during the first half of the tribulation period, although they could begin before it. It is at this point one of the most significant of the signs occurs, after which everything changes. Jesus told us that all Christians are to watch for the abomination of desolation described by the prophet Daniel in Daniel 9:27. Paul described this event as the moment when the Antichrist is revealed by sitting in the temple of God and proclaiming himself to be God. This is essentially God granting the Antichrist the authority for 42 months, as seen in Revelation 13:5. In Revelation 6, the parallel sign is the rider of the green horse, who is given authority again to kill over a quarter of the earth. This will be the beginning of the Great Tribulation. Will the Antichrist actually kill 25% of the earth's population? Well, considering Christians make up a quarter of that population now, or about 2 billion people, it may be close, But please notice, the beast is given authority to kill. It doesn't mean that he's going to kill that number. It is at this point in Matthew that Jesus tells us that the Great Tribulation begins. In Revelation, the parallel sign of the same event is the opening of the fifth seal. There the martyrs of all the ages cry out to God to begin to avenge their blood and to pour out his wrath. But God asks them to wait just a little bit longer before he avenges or pours out his wrath. Finally, with the sixth sign, Matthew tells us that God brings the Great Tribulation to an end with a miraculous sign in the heavens. First, the sun darkens. We see this exact same event in Revelation 6 as well. After the sun darkens, the moon also darkens. We see this same sign in Revelation 6. Then, in Matthew's Gospel, the stars fall, and we see this in Revelation 6 as well. Then something which almost defies explanation or description will happen. Matthew tells us the heavens are shaken. Revelation describes it as the sky is split open. Why is it opened? For the next big event, the biggest event of them all. But first, before that big event, both passages tell us the unrepentant of the world mourn and wail because they know what is about to happen. Revelation describes it as them crying out for the rocks and the mountains to fall on them and hide them. They are asking to be hidden from the presence of Jesus coming on the clouds in great power and glory. Revelation offers a unique detail. It shows Jesus coming seated upon his throne. This is another hugely misunderstood point, and nearly everyone misses that this is Jesus coming on the clouds while seated on his throne. Most commentators look at this verse, Revelation 6:16, and see the earth dwellers seeing God in the sky and assume that it's the Father on the throne. But the unrepentant are asking to be hidden from the face of him who is seated on the throne. The Father is spirit and invisible to those in earthly bodies. It is Jesus they are seeing, the visible person of the Trinity. So Jesus comes on the clouds, seated on the throne, not just walking on the clouds or riding a horse. And he referred to his coming this way two other times. When Jesus called out woe on the scribes and Pharisees, he indicated the way he would return coming on the clouds. He would be seated at the right hand of the power, which is God the Father. So both the Father and the Son are on the throne? It appears, yes, they are. But the earth dwellers only see the Son. Only he is visible. And in this 15th century painting of the sheep and goat judgment, Jesus is seated on his throne. But notice, he is seated above the earth. Where did the artist get this idea? Again, in this third reference, this one from Matthew 25, we see Jesus seated on his throne at his coming. The idea that Jesus comes walking on the clouds seems to be a modern one. And of course, this comparison of 13 exact events occurring in the exact same order also confirms that Revelation 6:16 is Jesus coming on the clouds, seated upon his throne. Now let's return to that comparison. After Jesus' coming is the 12th sign, the rapture. In Matthew 24, we see the gathering of saints while still on the earth by angels. And in Revelation 7:9, we see these same saints as a great multitude in heaven. The final sign is the wrath of God. In Matthew 24, we see Jesus presenting this symbolically as in the days of Noah when the wrath was water. And in Revelation 8, we see the actual beginning of the wrath of God as fire, which happens at the first trumpet judgment. So 13 signs or events are found in exactly the same order in two books of the Bible. Today's bonus concept, which we like to present at the end of each video, is this. What are the odds that these aren't the same events? The statistical odds are 1 in 3 trillion. Yep, that's pretty small odds. So, when we as Christians try to have a civil debate about some of these individual issues, we must remember that the odds that Revelation 6 through 8 and Matthew 24 aren't the same events is minuscule. 1 in 3 trillion. They are the same events. So when we begin to discuss the rider of the white horse, this event is about false messiahs as we are instructed in Matthew 24. Because all 13 signs are interrelated, happen in the same order, the two signs that are about the same idea are the same. So the odds that the rider of the white horse is Jesus, or Muhammad, or Saddam Hussein, or someone else, is 1 in 3 trillion. There's no chance of it. And when we discuss sign 11, the face that the unrepentant see on the throne in Revelation 6:16, it's Jesus. And this coming of Jesus is the same one that is pictured in Matthew 24:30. The odds against it are 1 in 3 trillion, based on statistics alone. Additionally, some argue that the wrath of God doesn't begin with the first trumpet. The odds are only 1 in 3 trillion that they are correct, because all 13 signs are interrelated. And finally, the odds that the gathering together in Matthew 24:31 and the great multitude of saints in Revelation 7:9, the odds that that isn't part of the same event is the same 1 in 3 trillion. They are the same event. This means the rapture happens after the sixth seal. The odds are overwhelming. When you debate these things individually, you may be able to make some interesting points. But when you consider that the events in Matthew 24 are the same as those in Revelation 6 through 8, well, there's no longer any argument. The combined odds of all those things happening in the same order and not being the same thing is just too overwhelming. The roadmap to the end times has always been a mysterious prophecy. But when we understand it, it is amazingly powerful. We hope you've enjoyed this video. If so, be sure to subscribe by clicking the small red button in the lower right. If you would like to see another video about a mysterious prophecy, watch Who Are the 144,000, another video in this series. And if you wonder about the great multitude in Revelation 7:9, watch the video Who Are the Great Multitude by clicking the link. Until next time, this is Nelson for the Gospel in the End Times.